Vous savez quelle est la différence entre les courts-métrages de thriller et de ghost? C'est simple. Il y en a un, il a révolutionné le monde de la musique et du vidéoclip. Et l'autre, bah, il est passé complètement inaperçu. Suivez-moi. Et pourtant, on parle quand même d'un des plus grands chefs-d'œuvre de Michael Jackson. Le film avait toutes les qualités à la fois visuelles et sonores pour rivaliser avec son grand frère de l'époque et à son tour révolutionner le monde du vidéoclip. Quand on regarde d'un peu plus près, on se rend compte qu'il y a plein d'éléments qui dépassaient tous les standards de l'époque. Je vous explique. C'est quand même pas étonnant car il y a quand même Stan Winston à la réalisation. On parle quand même du grand copain de James Cameron qui a géré tous les effets visuels de Alien, Terminator ou encore la création du T-Rex de Jurassic Park. Autant vous dire que le film avait toutes les cartes en main pour pouvoir dépasser Thriller. Maintenant, la vidéo va se décomposer en trois étapes. Il va y avoir les collectors, les interviews et une petite surprise pour la fin. C'est parti. On commence par la VHS promo de Sony qui a pour particularité d'avoir le premier montage de 1996 et qui est légèrement différente de celle que l'on connaît. Car à ce jour, pour nous les Français, la meilleure version qui est disponible, c'est cette version, celle du Laserdisc, qui comporte également les sous-titres français. On est le seul pays au monde à avoir eu ce privilège, et ça, c'est une réelle plus-value. Comme on peut le voir, la première version avait une approche un peu plus cartoonesque, et du coup le visage était beaucoup moins ressemblant. Personnellement, je suis bien content que cette scène ait été retravaillée, car la deuxième version est vraiment plus flippante. Et je trouve qu'à ce jour, les effets visuels tiennent toujours autant la route. La deuxième scène qui a aussi radicalement changé est celle de la dent du squelette, mais cette fois-ci, c'est au niveau du son. Sur la version finale, c'est le morceau Is It Scary qui est utilisé, alors que sur la VHS, on a juste une démo instrumentale de la chanson Too Bad. Je vous mets un petit comparatif. D'ailleurs, les quelques vidéos de Shanna Montagal, une des figurantes du court-métrage, avaient dévoilé des rushs où il n'avait pas encore les effets spéciaux inclus. Comme vous pouvez le voir, Michael a dû simuler tous les gestes et actions avant que les effets soient appliqués. On apprendra qu'il y a quelques années, un scan 3D complet de son visage qui a servi pour les différents effets avait été mis en vente pour 1,5 million de dollars. Et en parlant de 3D, une info qui est restée assez discrète dans la communauté est qu'en 1999, un projet Ghost 3D était en discussion pour le parc Wüstenbotch situé au Japon. Comme on peut le voir sur les concept art, il était prévu que avant d'accéder à la projection, on soit dans une salle reprenant le décor du manoir. L'idée était de recréer une magie comme pour Captain EO en 86, mais le projet fut abandonné. D'ailleurs, en parlant de Captain EO, sachez que pour la numérisation 4K pour la bobine, ça se passe très bien. Allez, passons aux estimations. Pour le prix internet, on serait sur une estimation à 250 euros actuellement. Par contre, pour un prix personnel, je serais plus à 170 euros. Bien sûr, la bonne affaire, et c'est ce qu'on veut tous, ce serait environ 100 euros. D'ailleurs, dites-moi dans les commentaires quelle version de la transformation du maire vous préférez.
Allez, on passe à un super collector car il parle de la musique de Ghost. Et je peux vous dire que ce collector, je l'ai recherché très longtemps. Voici le CD promotionnel de Nicolas Pike, dans lequel il y a la bande originale du film. C'est un collector que j'affectionne tout particulièrement. En bas, vous pouvez remarquer qu'il y a le nom, le prénom et l'ancien numéro de téléphone de l'ancienne représentante de Nicolas Pike, Kathy Schlossner. J'adore vraiment ce collector. D'ailleurs, ma chanson préférée, c'est The Ceiling Dance. C'est une musique qui me donne des frissons. À chaque fois que je l'entends, je suis vraiment comme un dingue. D'ailleurs, juste après, vous avez la musique Angel Descend, qui pour moi est une musique incontournable pour le film. Et en plus de ça, sur la pochette, vous voyez les 9 chansons qui apparaissent dans l'ordre dans lequel on les entend. C'est vraiment exceptionnel. Bon, inutile de vous dire que Kathy Schlossner, j'ai essayé déjà de l'appeler, ça ne marche pas. Par contre, vous pouvez quand même regarder juste en dessous de la vidéo. Je vous ai mis le lien en description pour télécharger toute cette bande originale. Et ça, c'est cadeau. Bonne écoute. Pour l'estimation de ce magnifique CD, en se basant sur les prix internet, on se retrouve à 750 euros. Mais attention, ce n'est pas parce qu'il est indiqué à ce prix-là que la cote est respectée. Si on devait me demander personnellement le prix de ce CD, en respectant la cote, on serait aux alentours des 400-450 euros. Maintenant, pour la bonne affaire, je pense que si vous le voyez aux alentours des 200 euros, même si c'est un certain prix, à ce prix-là, foncez!
Allez, pour conclure avec les collectors, je vais enfin pouvoir vous montrer un des objets les plus rares et surtout uniques de la période Ghost. Il s'agit du pass du tournage de 1993 de Michael sur lequel est mentionné « Is it scary ?»
et non Ghost. Car oui, il s'agissait à la base du tournage du court-métrage qui allait être un outil promotionnel pour le film de la famille Addams.
Et comme on peut le voir, il y a trois cases, Name, Fears et Signature. Et dans la case Fears, il y a une mention 3. Alors, je serais quand même assez curieux de savoir quelles sont les peurs de MJ, et si vous avez une idée, surtout n'hésitez pas à me le dire dans les commentaires. Ensuite, on retrouve une photo inédite de Michael en mode photomaton avec la chemise boutonnée jusqu'en haut. On a notamment vu dans les vlogs de Shanna qu'elle détient également ce pass ainsi que celui du tournage de 96 où à la place de Is It Scary est indiqué Too Bad.
Bon après, je vous avoue, je comprends pas vraiment l'utilité d'un pass pour Michael sur le tournage, mais à la fin, je remercie quand même l'initiative parce que ça nous fait quand même un sacré beau collector. Allez, passons à l'estimation.
Alors, vu que c'est un objet assez unique, je vous avouerai que pour cette estimation, c'est un peu particulier. Du coup, je pense que je vais vous citer la phrase que vous connaissez tous maintenant. Tout dépend du prix que vous êtes prêt à mettre.
Voilà, j'espère que ces trois collecteurs vous auront plu. En tout cas, moi, ça a été un réel plaisir de vous les partager. Comme promis, on peut passer maintenant aux interviews. Et on va commencer avec la personne qui est à l'origine de la création de cette magnifique pochette. Je veux bien sûr parler de Christophe Boulmé. Allez, c'est parti. Salut Christophe, tu vas bien? Eh bien en tout cas, un grand merci pour avoir accepté cette invitation pour l'interview, ça me touche beaucoup. Je te propose, si tu veux, on rentre dans le vif du sujet directement. Je sais que tu es à l'origine de la création de l'artwork de Ghost. Du coup, est-ce que tu peux nous en dire un petit peu plus sur ton état d'esprit au moment de cette création?
Salut Pitou, merci de me recevoir pour répondre à ces quelques questions. Ghost, ben écoute, Ghost, à l'époque, je pense qu'on était dans une opulence, une frénésie incroyable qui fait que j'étais totalement immergé dans l'univers de Michael. Et si je me souviens bien, si mes souvenirs sont bons, ce jour-là, Michael avait fait sa conférence de presse au Palais des Congrès pour présenter sa collaboration avec le prince Al-Walid. Et en sortant de ça, on avait rendez-vous au Georges V avec lui. Sachant pas particulièrement ce qui allait nous attendre, toute l'aventure du Georges V a déjà été racontée par Laurent dans Black and White. C'est succulent parce qu'on a fait deux allers-retours, je crois, où on avait le temps de le voir, où on n'avait pas le temps de le voir. Et puis à un moment donné, on s'est retrouvés tous les quatre dans le hall d'hôtel, Michael compris, et il a commencé à nous communiquer son enthousiasme par rapport à ce qui allait venir, et entre autres ce qu'il appelait donc Ghost. Et j'ai bouffé ses paroles, même si je comprenais un mot sur deux, et si ça allait très très vite pour moi, j'arrivais quand même à comprendre l'essence de ce qui se passait. Et j'ai surtout vraiment ressenti sa fierté et sa joie de pouvoir communiquer ce travail. Et il nous a vraiment donné des détails précis de ce que ça allait être. Moi, j'avais rien vu, je connaissais rien, je m'y attendais pas du tout d'ailleurs à ce qu'il nous raconte ça. Mais j'ai senti en moi une flopée d'inspiration et d'enthousiasme. Je me souviens qu'après, on est allé dans un café avec Laurent, qui nous a, à moi et Julien, traduit 95% de ce qui s'était échangé par rapport à ça. Je suis rentré chez moi direct. J'avais déjà des images en tête. Je me souviens très bien, même en conduisant à la voiture, j'avais déjà des images en tête de ce que je voulais faire. Et puis j'ai dû faire spontanément 3-4 essais, dont deux ont été publiés dans le magazine quelques semaines après. Et très très vite, ce qui a été retenu, ça a été la version avec Michael à moitié squelette et l'autre part de visage. Et tout est parti de là. Voilà, après ça a été très 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 vite.
Ok, d'accord, ça marche. Mais du coup, l'idée que tu as eue pour la cover de Ghost, est-ce que c'est quelque chose qui a pu évoluer au fur et à mesure du temps? Ou est-ce que du coup, c'est la pochette qu'on connaît tous actuellement?
Est-ce que ça a été ma... Non, ça n'a pas évolué du tout. C'est vraiment le premier jet. Alors, comme je l'ai dit tout à l'heure, effectivement, j'ai quand même fait trois ou quatre versions, je ne sais plus. Deux qui sont restées dans les tiroirs et deux qui ont été publiées dans le magazine. Celle qui est restée et qui a fait son chemin, c'est donc cette version-là que vous voyez derrière moi. Et voilà. Non, ça a été premier jet, tout premier jet.
Mais du coup, est-ce que tu as quand même fait plusieurs propositions de pochettes à Sony? Est-ce qu'il y a eu des retouches éventuellement? Est-ce qu'il y a eu des va-et-vient par rapport à ça? Il y a des choses qui ont changé? Est-ce que tu peux nous en dire un peu plus là-dessus?
Ouais, alors autour de ça, il n'y a pas des tonnes, comme je te l'ai dit. Hein, ça a été bon du premier coup, mais c'est vrai que la composition finale est faite d'éléments. J'ai la même version, mais avec le visage entier. J'ai les éléments séparés, évidemment. Et je m'en suis servi, d'ailleurs, pour faire des rectos de singles, de versions alternatives ou de choses comme ça. Mais non, par contre, il n'y a pas de tonnes de préparation, il n'y a pas eu de tonnes d'esquisses ou de machin, etc. Non, je me suis vraiment jeté à l'aveugle sur ce coup-là. Et c'est marrant parce que, dès le départ, je l'ai conçu un peu comme une affiche de film. Dans ma tête. Et pour moi, c'est un peu resté comme une affiche de film, d'ailleurs.
Alors, du coup, je sais qu'on ne parle pas assez souvent de ça. Je sais que tu as pris une photo de la période Bad pour le visage de Michael. Je t'avoue, c'est quelque chose qui me fascine assez parce que je me dis qu'à l'époque, normalement, Sony aurait pu proposer des photos, alors peut-être promotionnelles ou sur les tournages ou pour les pubs, des choses comme ça. Et je me dis que tu as quand même sélectionné cette photo-là et ça m'intrigue vraiment. Est-ce que tu peux nous dire pourquoi cette photo en particulier et pas, par exemple, une photo de la période history?
Alors, tu es très, très, très fort parce qu'effectivement, je crois que tu es un des premiers qui a remarqué que c'était effectivement un visage de la période Bad. Je crois que beaucoup de gens sont persuadés que j'étais repris à partir de mon visage iconique que j'ai emprunté à Gorman et qui me servait un peu de logotype l'emmener dans plein d'univers et ce visage logotypé qui m'a servi énormément, ben non, pas du tout, c'est pas du tout le même. Effectivement, j'ai tombé sur cette photo de Bat qui, je trouve, au niveau de la perspective et de l'expression, matchait mieux avec le squelette. Et c'est pour ça que j'ai utilisé celle-là. Voilà.
Alors, j'ai une autre question en tête. Je me dis, on est en 2021. Allez, pour les 25 ans de Ghost, Christophe Boulmé va faire une nouvelle pochette pour Ghost. Du coup, avec les technologies actuelles, est-ce que tu partirais plus sur de la 3D? Est-ce que, au contraire, tu serais vraiment resté sur l'original, peut-être avec des petits changements par-ci par-là? Qu'est-ce que tu pourrais nous partager à travers ça?
Aujourd'hui, non. Je pense pas que l'illustration aurait la même texture. D'ailleurs, oui, effectivement, je me suis lancé dans quelques mises à jour, je dirais, des années 2000 en m'aidant de la 3D, choses comme ça. J'en avais partagé quelques-unes sur Facebook, et puis j'ai arrêté très très vite parce que tout le monde prenait ça pour des trucs officiels, alors qu'en fait pas du tout, c'était juste un plaisir personnel. Mais Ghost se revisiter aujourd'hui, non, ça aurait évidemment pas du tout la même texture parce que c'est pas les mêmes outils et voilà quoi, je veux dire. Et puis moi aussi, j'ai grandi, j'ai évolué, hein, je me sers plus du même outil et je fais plus du tout les choses de la même manière. C'est très vintage pour moi, ce que j'ai derrière moi, c'est très le reflet d'une époque et des moyens d'une époque. Ça, c'est clair.
Alors, je sais que tu fais partie d'un, on va dire, tu es impliqué dans un collector et c'est celui-ci. C'est le coffret pour Ghost. Et du coup, je me dis que là, le choix de la photo, ça m'intrigue. En fait, on retrouve un Michael pas parfaitement éclairé ni ultra retouché, mais c'est plus un Michael un peu brut, un peu vrai. Alors d'ailleurs, je trouve que ça représente bien l'ambiance du film. Et du coup, je me dis, mais pourquoi cette photo, en fait, tout simplement? Est-ce que tu peux nous en dire plus là-dessus?
Ouais, alors le coffret Ghost, moi, j'étais totalement livré à moi-même. Hein. J'étais en roue libre. C'était vraiment... Et pour la photo de couverture, eh ben écoute, c'est un bel accident en fait, parce que on a attendu des semaines pour avoir des documents, pour avoir des photos, et ça venait pas. Je sais pas ce qui se passait, mais c'était très compliqué d'avoir des photos du tournage. Évidemment, est arrivée celle-là, on l'a trouvée absolument sublime. Moi, je la trouvais pas flagrante pour une couverture, mais ça me paraissait impératif que ça passe par ce portrait pas évident. Mais qui effectivement, comme tu le dis, est bien dans l'ambiance du clip, est bien brut de brut, et au final, c'est plus ça a vieilli et plus je trouve que le coffret, même si j'en étais pas très très satisfait au départ, Je trouve que le coffret a acquis ce petit côté cultissime incontournable. Et voilà. Mais très honnêtement, pour être très honnête, j'ai pas eu énormément de documents pour travailler dessus. Et j'avais pas trop le choix. Et j'avais pas envie de répéter l'illustration sur le coffret. J'avais envie d'un truc beaucoup plus riche. Donc voilà, c'est comme ça que c'est né aussi.
Je sais qu'il y a eu une projection au Festival de Cannes en 1997 pour le film Ghost. Alors, à mon avis, il n'y a pas eu meilleure situation pour pouvoir expérimenter ce film, à la fois visuellement, même niveau sonore. Du coup, est-ce que toi, tu as eu la chance d'y assister justement à cette projection ?
Bah écoute, non, j'ai pas été à Cannes. Désolé. Non, j'ai pas été à Cannes, donc j'ai pas vu le court-métrage en avant-première. Je l'ai découvert chez moi, à la télé, comme tout le monde. Et c'est très drôle d'ailleurs, parce que de se dire que j'ai été quand même à la base de toute cette création autour de cet événement sans avoir vu une seule image, et, ni une seule photo, ni quoi que ce soit, ça veut vraiment dire que j'étais totalement en immersion dans son univers à ce moment-là et qu'on était totalement connectés, quoi. Ça, pour moi, c'est ça que ça symbolise. Ça me paraît évident.
Alors, on est d'accord, hein. Il y a plein de scènes cultes dans le film Ghost. Tout le monde a ses petites préférences, hein. Ça peut être début, milieu, fin. En tout cas, moi, j'en ai une. C'est celle où on voit Michael étirer son visage comme ça avec les effets spéciaux de l'époque. C'est complètement dingue. Je trouve que c'est vraiment, vraiment super. Ça me donne des frissons à chaque fois. Mais du coup, toi, tu dois bien avoir une scène préférée. Est-ce que tu peux nous dire quelle est cette scène et du coup, bah, pourquoi ?
Ma scène préférée de Ghost, c'est quand c'est peut-être la scène la plus violente pour moi. C'est celle où il se fracasse les mains sur le sol et que son visage commence à s'effriter en poussière. Évidemment, moi à l'époque, après tout ce qu'on avait traversé, tout ce qu'on avait vécu à travers lui, tout ce qu'on en disait, c'est quelque chose qui a été percutant pour moi, parce que c'était un énorme symbole, une énorme parabole de ce qu'il représentait, c'est-à-dire quelqu'un d'énorme qui était le roi de la distraction mondiale, mais en même temps était un des gars les plus attaqués de la planète, quoi. Moi, j'ai toujours été en contradiction avec ça, parce que moi, je l'ai toujours trouvé normal. Même dans ce qu'on pourrait appeler ces bizarreries, moi je l'ai toujours trouvé normal. Il était Michael Jackson, il faisait ce qu'il voulait. Je veux dire, c'était pas à moi d'avoir un jugement, de savoir si c'est. Et puis, très honnêtement, la question ne s'est jamais posée. Moi je l'ai toujours trouvé. Voilà quoi. Je veux dire, j'ai jamais eu de choc. C'est peut-être la première fois où je l'ai vu arriver avec les cheveux extrêmement raides, extrêmement défrisés. La première fois, oui, ça m'a fait un peu bizarre. Mais c'est très très vite passé quoi. Voilà. Mais c'était lui le patron, il faisait ce qu'il voulait, quoi. Donc, mais c'est vrai que cette image-là, du court-métrage, pour moi, je savais que ça représentait quelque chose de très intime, très, très... Et ça m'a toujours perturbé, et dans sa violence, et dans sa beauté. Parce que j'ai toujours trouvé ce passage extrêmement bien réalisé. Et je pense que si j'avais vu le court-métrage avant de faire l'affiche, je me demande si je ne me serais pas lancé sur un projet... avec ça en clin d'œil, bon, j'aurais peut-être fait le buzz, hein. Non, c'est pas le buzz qu'on dit, le spoil. Mais c'est vraiment une image qui m'a marqué et qui me marquera encore longtemps d'ailleurs.
Alors, pour conclure cette interview, est-ce que tu aurais une anecdote de la période Ghost que tu aimerais partager avec nous ?
Moi, personnellement, ce que j'en garde. C'est essentiellement de la fierté parce que c'est quand même un des tout premiers collecteurs français à avoir été lancé grâce à tout ça, qui a pu se négocier, qui a pu se vendre, qui a pu exister. Je pense que c'est l'association de plein de choses et évidemment, sans avoir les chevilles qui enflent, en grande partie liée à mes initiatives, quoi. Donc j'en garde un souvenir, une émotion de fierté très forte. Très intense. Voilà. Je crois que c'est fini. Hein.
C'est fini, Christophe.
Donc il est temps pour moi de te dire au revoir.
Ça marche. Eh bien, Christophe, un grand merci.
Ben, merci à toi, Quentin. Bonne continuation et très jolie collection. Et continue, quoi.
Merci.
Ciao.
Salut, Christophe.
Salut, tout le monde.
Voilà, alors du coup, un très très grand merci à Christophe pour avoir pris le temps de répondre à toutes mes questions. Je vous conseille son livre, hein, intitulé Michael. Il y a plein d'anecdotes, il y a plein de super belles photos, des histoires, tout ça. Si vous le voyez en rayon, foncez, il est vraiment super. Allez, pour la prochaine interview, on va parler d'une personne qui a participé au tournage de Ghost. Elle a écrit un livre et en plus de ça, elle connaissait assez bien Michael. Je veux bien sûr parler de Shana Mantagal. C'est parti.
Bonjour Shana, alors on va commencer l'interview. Du coup, première question, tu as pu rencontrer, travailler et tu as même fait partie du projet avec Michael. Étant toi-même une grande fan, est-ce que l'idée que tu avais de lui à l'époque a changé par la suite une fois ce tournage terminé? Ou est-ce que du coup ton idée est restée la même?
It wasn't the same, and it wasn't that different. Because he was the Michael that you had grown to know over the years on TV and, you know, music and all this. But there was another side to him that you didn't see and that I was surprised about. And it was basically the fact that he was just normal. You know, you just don't expect him to be normal. But the thing that a lot of fans don't understand, and not just with Michael, but with any celebrity, celebrities live day to day. And most of those hours that these celebrities are living, we don't get to see it. You know, we don't see what they're doing every day. So what people don't realize is that celebrities are people too. You know, they have a regular life. They do what we do. You know, it's just like we don't get to see it because it's boring, you know. So they're living a normal life. And that's what you realize when you become friends with someone like a Michael Jackson. You're like, oh, he's just like one of us. He's doing the same stuff we're doing. And that was surprising. But it was also endearing, and it made him even more appealing and attractive, because you could relate to him. And like whenever I talked to him about something, he could relate to it. It was never like, oh, what are you talking about? He was always like, I understand. Yeah. I remember that too. Or yeah, I do. You know, he was a very good conversationalist, and he also loved asking questions. He was very inquisitive, and he wanted to learn as much about you as you wanted to learn about him. And that was a really nice quality that he had. And that's one of the things that made people love him who knew him, because he was just likable. You know, you just liked him. I don't think anyone who knew him, people who knew him loved him. To know Michael was to love him, basically. Even guys, like, it's not just women. Like, I saw grown men, like, just fall all over themselves when Michael was around. They would get nervous. They would, like, some would, like, cry. They're like, oh, my God, I can't believe I'm talking to Michael Jackson. But these are, like, hardened, you know, like, men, and they would act like girls around Michael, because, you know, everyone grew up with Michael. And then when you met him and he was just so wonderful and personable, it just kind of made you love him. And it didn't matter if you were young, old, male, female, he had that effect on every single person he met.
Alors, à l'époque, en 93, le court-métrage s'appelait Is It Scary et non Ghost. Mais du coup, est-ce que tu te souviens de ton tout premier jour de tournage, justement, dans cette première version?
When I was cast in the video, I remember the first day, I asked Michael if he had recorded that song yet. And he said, no, I didn't. I haven't even recorded it yet. So we were on the set of that short film, and he didn't even have the song recorded yet. So I was like, you know, this is strange, because how are we going to do the dance scenes if the song isn't recorded yet? But, you know, there were things going on in his life at that time that was kind of distracting him.
Alors, dans la version de 93, dans le montage qu'on trouve sur YouTube, la première version n'inclut pas des scènes de danse, mais d'ailleurs aucune. Est-ce que du coup, il y avait des scènes de danse de prévues sur cette fameuse chanson Family Things?
The 96 version didn't exist, of course, none of it at that time. And because the song didn't exist in 93, I never got to see the dance portion at all. And I remember seeing Michael, because we filmed Is This Scary on one sound stage, and then the dance was going to be like on another sound stage, I think. And we were supposed to meet at this other sound stage. So I remember I went to the other sound stage and Michael was there, and it was like nighttime, and he was watching the dancers perform, even though we didn't really have a song. But he didn't join in. He was just standing back watching, like he had his mask on and everything. And that was the extent of the dance portion of that video. He never did anything. He just watched what the dancers were doing. Because again, by that time, he had been calling in sick, and I knew something was wrong. And I guess he probably knew that he wasn't going to be able to go through with this, because there was a lot happening that at the time we didn't know what was going on. All we knew was that Michael was sick, because he had started calling in sick almost every day and not showing up. But he did show up on that last day, which was August 17th. And that was what we were doing August 17th. He was watching the dancers dance.
Et une fois que cette version de 93 a été arrêtée, comment est-ce que le projet a pu reprendre et du coup s'est transformé en Ghost?
Well, Michael, you know, he was adamant that he was going to finish this film. This was his baby. The theme of it was something that he wanted the world to know and understand about him. This was something that he had to get out there. And so all that time he was planning it. I didn't know this. I didn't know anything about this until he called me. Like a week before we started filming Ghost, Michael called me and asked me if I would be in it with him. And I was like, yeah, I didn't even know that this was gonna happen. And here he is calling me, asking me if I would be in it. And he was kind of nervous when he called. He was stuttering, almost as if like he thought I wouldn't say yes. And I was like, of course, Michael, I'll be in this with you. But he told me that, I remember when he called, he said, you know, I want this to be scarier than Thriller. That was his whole goal with Ghosts. He wanted it to be scarier than Thriller. And he said, you're the only cast member I'm bringing back from Is This Scary? You know, I can't bring the kids back because they're all grown, you know, they've grown up now, so we can't use them. You're the only one I'm bringing back. So I was like, oh my God, thank you, Michael. And then he told me that the casting people would be calling me. And so like, I'd say 2 hours later, the casting people called me and they asked for me by name. And they were like, Michael Jackson told us to call you. And I was like, wow, you know, Michael told you to call. That, just little things like that were like big to me back then. You know, I was like, wow, so Michael knows my whole name, because the casting people knew my whole name. And I didn't even know Michael knew my whole name. But, you know, just little things like that that stand out in my memory that, really, you know, just endeared me to Michael and just made me really in love with him, because he was just so sweet. But he told me not to tell anybody. That was a funny thing. His own managers, I was still working for the management company in 1996, but he was kind of like on the outs with them at this time, which a lot of that had to do with Ghosts, because Sony wouldn't pay for Ghosts. He had to pay for Ghosts like out of his own pocket. And he felt like his managers, who were my bosses, weren't really fighting for him with Sony, you know, to get this thing funded. But Sony, you know, said that it was too expensive. So Michael had to pay for it himself. So when I say that Ghosts was his baby, it really was. He paid for it himself. Everything was all Michael. So everything you see in the Ghost short film is all Michael. He was there every day. He was early before all of us even got to the set. He would get there at like 5 a.m. and stay until like 11 p.m. He pretty much lived on that set. His mother actually had to start coming to pull him away from the set so that he could get some sleep. And that was the only way he would leave, is when his mother came and told him, Michael, you got to get some rest, because he loved it there. I think that was actually like the best experience he's ever had filming something, because we were there for like 30 days, like a month. It was like filming a movie, and every day was just filled with just laughter, and he could be himself. You know, there were kids in it, so we were all just like, we were like a gang. It was almost like we were in high school, you know, back in school, because every day we would play games, we would, you know, do practical jokes on each other. And Michael was just like one of us. And he was really cool, and he was an actor too. You know, this is acting was his passion, so he was able to act, and I was blessed enough to be able to act with him. We did a lot of improv. It wasn't there weren't like lines that were written on a script, because you mentioned a script earlier. There was a script, but none that we use. You know, the director would just say, okay, this is what's going to happen, and just do that. And so we just kind of like improvise, and it was really fun doing that with Michael. He's a good actor, and yeah, we had fun acting together.
Et comment le réalisateur a pu vous diriger pour vous dire, bah voilà, il faut l'émotion de la joie, l'émotion de la tristesse, de la peur, etc.
So the director was really great, Stan Winston. He would just walk us through these reactions, and we'd just play off of what Stan was telling us. So really, we weren't seeing anything. Stan Winston was telling us what to do. And he was great, because he would just walk us through the emotions. I remember the scene where Michael, Maestro dies, and he's like on the floor, you know, the part where he's on the floor and he's pretty much dead. And Michael, as the mayor, is standing right here next to me. And so Stan Winston walked us through Michael's death. And so Michael experienced his own death right next to me. And I started tearing up, because the director was so great. He really made us feel it. I could feel that Michael was gone, but then Michael was right next to me. He's like, you know, I'm right here. Because I was really, you know, crying. It was sad. But that's how we did it. The camera would shoot our reactions, and Stan Winston, the director, would kind of just walk us through it. And then when the camera turned onto Maestro, we'd watch Michael Jackson as Maestro, and he wouldn't be the mayor anymore. It would just be, you know, townspeople. So yeah, it was really interesting how they shot it.
Une fois que Michael s'est transformé en ce personnage du maire, c'était quand même quelque chose d'incroyable à l'époque pour le maquillage, tout ça. Comment il a pu s'adapter sur ce rôle? Parce qu'il est quand même complètement à l'opposé de son propre personnage.
Yeah, when he was the mayor, he was completely different, because I think he liked it that we couldn't see his face. All I could see were his eyes. I remember the very first day that he came out as the mayor, because the first day of filming, he was Maestro. And in fact, our very first day of filming, he did the Too Bad. He filmed the Too Bad dance and singing parts. So that was my first day on set of Ghost, watching Michael dance and sing to Too Bad. I think they wanted to get those scenes out of the way, because they didn't do them in the 1993 version. So they were like, we're gonna do that first. In case anything happens, we're gonna get these dancing and singing scenes out of the way. So I remember it was like late at night, and I was standing there, and the music starts blasting. And it was my very first time hearing, I don't think I'd heard Too Bad before, at least not in this form. It was, you know, it was really loud. And his voice was just booming out of the speakers. And he's standing like right in front of me with his Michael Jackson Maestro outfit on, and the wind's blowing through his hair. And I was just standing there like kind of by myself. Because he always let me watch all of his scenes, even if the townspeople weren't in those scenes. The townspeople would usually be like on another stage, like in a holding area, as they called it, waiting for our part to come up. But I always stayed on set to watch Michael do all of his scenes, whether I was needed or not. I was like, I'm not gonna miss this opportunity to, you know, see a master at work. And that was just like magical, to stand there and watch him do the most amazing choreography I've ever seen in my entire life. When he went into that, you know, Too Bad, I was like, oh, it just looked like he was a puppet on a string. It was amazing. And then like every time they would break, there would be a break, he'd come over and talk to me. And so, you know, when you're watching the dance scene, when I watch it, I just remember him talking to me. And the funny thing is what he was talking about. You know, you would think, I know people were wondering what he's talking to her about, but it was like the stupidest stuff ever we were talking about. I remember the first thing, like when he had a break, he walked over and he said, "So, who's taking your place at work?" You know, he wanted to know who was taking my place at work. And then he asked me if his managers knew I was there with him, because he hadn't told them. I had to tell them. I was like, "Yeah, you know, I told them, you know, that I'm here with you." And he said, "What did they say? What was their reaction when you told them you're gonna do this short film with me?" So that was the kind of stuff that he wanted to know and that we were talking about. So it was just like, you know, regular stuff, nothing out of this world, just like regular stuff that we talked about. But yeah, seeing Michael in his Michael Jackson clothes, it was different than seeing him as the mayor, because when he was the mayor, I forgot he was Michael, and he didn't act like Michael anymore. He was, you know, he was not the Michael Jackson you're used to. He was even more down to earth when he was the mayor.
Et est-ce que la voix du maire que l'on entend dans la version finale a été changée en post-production, parce qu'on entend qu'elle est quand même assez grave, ou est-ce que Michael a su garder justement cette voix-là pendant le tournage?
Exactly the same. They didn't change anything. Michael's great at imitating voices. That's one of his talents that, you know, people don't know. I remember when I first started working with him for his manager, the first time I had to call him, I called him and he answered in a British voice, but I didn't know it was him. He said, "Hello." I said, "Hi, is Michael there?" And he said, "Who's calling?" And I said, "It's Shauna in Sandy Gallen's office." And he said, "Put him through." And he was acting like he was his own assistant. And so I started giggling, and then he started giggling. And I was like, "Michael," you know, when he giggled, I knew it was him. So, but that's how he always answered the phone. He always pretended like he was his own assistant. He was always good with imitating voices. But the mayor's voice was, I just got used to it as like being like his regular voice, really, because it wasn't really that different from, you know, how he usually talked.
Alors, je me suis toujours demandé, est-ce qu'il y avait une ou plusieurs scènes qui ont été tournées à l'époque et qui n'ont pas été gardées dans la version finale de Ghost?
Sure. A lot of stuff. Yeah, totally. I mean, because in that dance scene, I'm sure Lavelle, if he told you, they did it over and over again. Like, Michael was a perfectionist. And the very first time they did it, I was like, "Yeah, that was great." And then Michael, he always looked over to me to see what my reaction was to stuff. And I remember I was like, did like that and like clapping. But every time he was like, "Can we do that again?" And I remember one time they did it again simply because he didn't like the way the dancer's socks looked. One of the dancer's socks wasn't sparkling enough. So they had to do the whole thing over again simply because of that. Because they'd do it and then we'd watch it on the monitor. And then he'd be like, oh, look at that sock. You see that sock over there? Let's do this again. So he was a perfectionist. And, you know, a lot of people who work with him, that's one thing that, you know, people might complain about with Michael. He was a perfectionist, and he was a taskmaster. He made you do it over and over again until it was perfect in his eyes. It was already perfect in our eyes, but in his eyes, he could see like every little mistake, even when, you know, you didn't think there was a mistake. So yeah, he made sure it was perfect, and that's why it looks like it does, you know, on film. He made sure of that. Oh, and look what I have. I forgot. I have my shoes. My original shoes. Ghost. And the dust from the set is still on there. You see it? That's the dust from the set of Ghost.
Alors, j'ai vu sur ta chaîne YouTube, que je mettrai en description d'ailleurs, sur certaines vidéos, tu montres le pass du tournage. Mais à quoi servait exactement ce pass?
To get in, you know, because you couldn't just walk on a Michael Jackson set. You had to have a pass. It's like a backstage pass almost. Like if you go to his concert, you would need a pass as well. So this, you had to show, you know, when you walked on set every morning, showed to the security, and it just showed that you were supposed to be there. And oh, and I also found, I have a ton of these, like every day they would give us these. So it told us what we were filming that day. So this is the whole list of all the scenes and what time Michael had to show up. This was day 11. It says 11 of 12, but we end up shooting for like 30 days. So it ended up being more than 12. And we shot, let's see, Maestro bows and talks to the mayor. People watch the mayor jump out of the glass door. It was when the maestro jumped out of that glass door. And it has Michael. He had to be on set at 6 a.m. that day. And the set call was 8 a.m. So it took him 2 hours to become the mayor. And then my call time was also 6 a.m. Wow. Yeah, we had really early. See, it says Michael Jackson. He played all the roles. Michael Jackson, Michael Jackson, Michael Jackson.
Alors, j'ai vu qu'il y avait une référence à un cascadeur sur l'affiche. Et je me dis, est-ce que ce cascadeur était présent afin de faire des scènes pour Michael?
It was Stan Winston's son. Stunt double. So anytime there was a mayor thing where it was something like that, it was Stan Winston's son who was dressed as the mayor. And he was an adult. He wasn't a child. It was, what's his name? Matt Winston. He's on Facebook, actually. Matt Winston. Yep. His name is probably here somewhere. Yeah, that was a stunt double. But everything else was Michael, except for when the maestro was on and you saw Michael's face. If maestro and mayor were in the same scene, of course, that wasn't Michael as the mayor. It was someone dressed. It was probably Matt Winston dressed as the mayor. And then when it was Michael and the mayor was Michael, we had his stand-in, Derek. Was his stand-in, Derek Morgan.
Alors, sais-tu pourquoi certaines scènes de 93 ont été gardées pour la version de 96? Je me demande pourquoi, du coup, elles n'ont pas été tout simplement retournées. Parce qu'on arrive quand même à distinguer qu'entre ces deux versions, entre la première et la deuxième, eh ben, on voit que Michael n'a pas vraiment la même coupe de cheveux. Est-ce que tu sais pourquoi ça n'a pas été retourné?
Because the special effects are very expensive, so that, you know, they did it to save money. They could, you know, no need to redo those special effects scenes when they were already super expensive, because most people wouldn't notice that the hair was different.
Alors, Ghost étant vraiment le projet de Michael, on va dire c'est carrément son bébé, hein, est-ce qu'il avait déjà mentionné éventuellement de faire une performance live à un moment donné?
No, not that I know of. I know he was wanting, like in 2009, he wanted to bring Ghost back and have it as like a Halloween special. That was his thing. He wanted the world to see Ghost. And that was one of his plans that they found like some notes, you know, after he passed away. And one of the notes was that he wanted Ghost, you know, to be a Halloween special. And every time I saw Michael after we filmed Ghost, Ghost was our topic of conversation. He always brought it up. He always brought up the practical jokes that we played on each other. He always brought up how much fun we had. And he just remembered like everything about it. And so it makes me feel good that he looked back on the filming of Ghost as like one of his happiest moments. Because really, it was one of his last like happy working experiences, because I know he did like You Rock My World video. He hated that. He didn't like filming that. You know, there were a lot of directors he may not have gotten along with, or he didn't like how he looked in certain videos. And so he sometimes he wouldn't show up to those videos, but Ghost, he was there every day. Early, you know, all day. Like we spent like at least 12 hours a day together on that film, and it bonded us. And it was a really special time.
Et est-ce que Michael a pu te parler de son ressenti pour la version finale de Ghost?
Yeah, he loved it because he was in the editing room, so he made sure that every shot that you saw, he approved, because he was in the editing room with the editor, you know, approving all the shots. So whatever you see on Ghost is something Michael wanted you to see. Previously on other films, he didn't have that kind of control. Ghost was his. He produced it. He did everything. So he was able to pretty much, you know, dictate how he looked and how the public saw the final cut of it. Like, for instance, the video, Who Is It?, which never came out here in America. He hated it so much. Like, he hated how he looked. And I feel like he looks great in that Who Is It video. But he did not want it to come out. Once he saw the first cut of it, he was like, this can't come out because I don't like how I look. He actually called the office crying one night when he got the first dailies, as they call it, and he saw how he looked in the video. He was like, we got to reshoot this. Can they, you know, change something in post-production? I hate the way I look. And he was just, he was so upset. And I never understood that, because I think that's like one of the videos where he looks the best. So that's the difference, you know, with Ghost, he just loved it. You Are Not Alone, he loved how he looked in that. He loved how he looked in Given to Me. But, you know, some of the, he hated You Rock My World, how he looked in that. He hated Who Is It? Yeah, so.
Et sais-tu éventuellement si un jour, je dis bien un jour, il y aurait une possibilité que Ghost puisse sortir en 4K ou en Blu-ray?
I asked John Branca at the premiere if they had plans for it. He said, yes, we're making it into 3D. And he said they were going to do it the following year. Or, you know, within the next couple of years, and then Leaving Neverland came out. So it just wiped away all those plans. But I hope that, you know, they reconsider, and because they must have already done it, because he was like, oh yeah, it's coming out. We're doing it in 3D. So it's almost like they had already done it and they were just waiting to release it. So I hope they do. Ghost in 3D, can you imagine that? That would be just amazing.
Et du coup, Shana, après toutes ces années, quelle est ta scène préférée de Ghost?
Well, it's a personal scene for me because mm-hmm. it's a scene where the scene where the mayor turns around and it's after Maestro is on the floor, supposedly dead, and then the mayor turns around and says, "Let's go." He turns around and he walks and he says that line to me. And I wasn't expecting him to say that line to me. We didn't rehearse it at all. The camera started rolling and he said, "Let's go." And then he walked and he turned to me and he said, "Let's go." And it surprised me. But you know, we had to stay in character and in the moment. I almost started laughing because I thought he was like playing another practical joke on me. But the cameras were rolling, so I was like, oh no, I have to act here. So I looked him in the eyes and we had like a moment where we just like looked in each other's eyes and he said, "Let's go." And then I had to turn back around and look at Maestro, who was dead on the floor, and you know, my eyes had to say like, no, you know, I don't want to leave Michael there dead on the floor. And he, you know, walked away. And then I looked back and, you know, I was looking at, it was a dummy on the floor dressed as Michael Jackson. And so it was like Michael telling me to leave Michael, you know, and it was just really deep. And it was funny that he picked me to, you know, do that little scene with. And we had to do it like many, many times. And each time, you know, he did it the same way and we did it the same way. So that was my favorite because, you know, we really had to like act with each other and improv. And he surprised me. And the first time we did it, after, you know, he walks over to the door. All this is in the film. He says, "Let's go." Then he walks to the door and turns around. And then when they yelled cut, he started giggling. He looked at me and started giggling like, "I got you. You know, you weren't expecting that, were you?" So like, that's the kind of stuff he would do like every day. He would just surprise me with something. But I love that scene because it's in there. Like you can like see it happening and you can see the look on my face almost, of me like being kind of surprised. But yeah, that was my favorite scene.
Et d'ailleurs, aurais-tu une anecdote à nous partager autour du tournage de Ghost ou éventuellement avec Michael?
So this particular time, House, who was Michael's personal assistant, came over to me and he said, go over to Michael and say to him, Michael, will you please give me some freedom? And I said, what does that mean? And he said, trust me, just go say that to Michael and see what happens. I was like, okay. You know, I was worried because Michael was in the middle of filming a scene and he wanted me to go like in the middle of the scene and tap Michael on the shoulder and tell him this. But I was like, okay, I'll do it. So I went over there and I tapped Michael on the shoulder and I whispered in his ear and I said, Michael, will you please give me some freedom? And he looked at me. He said, what? I said, will you please give me some freedom? And he said, House put you up to this, didn't he? I said, yeah. He said, do you know what freedom means? I said, no. He said, you really want to know? I said, yeah, I want to know. He said, no, I'm not going to tell you. I said, Michael, you have to tell me. What does it mean? He said, oh, I can't, I'm not going to tell you. I said, you have to tell me. What is it? He said, okay, I'll tell you. So he grabbed me by the hand and he led me off of the set, away from everybody. So I'm thinking, what is freedom going to mean? You know, why is he doing this? So he led me away from everybody. And he said, okay, you really want to know what freedom means? I said, yes, what does it mean? He said, it means to pass gas. You know, like, like the cut, that was Michael's humor. And I remember like after that, I was standing next to the mayor, Michael, and I smelled something. And I said, oh my God, the mayor just passed gas? And Michael's like, no, that wasn't me. He was like, it was him. He blamed it on one of the kids. I said, it wasn't him. It was, you know, it was you. So that's like the kind of stuff we would do like all day. That was Michael's humor. And you know, Michael's favorite comedian was Benny Hill. So that was the kind of stuff that, you know, he liked, like bathroom humor and just like off color, dirty jokes. He loved dirty jokes and things like, that's the kind of stuff people wouldn't expect about Michael, but it's what really you know, made you love him, because he was just so funny and he just kept us laughing just all day long. So yeah.
Alors tu as sorti un livre qui parle de ton expérience avec Michael et également ton expérience à travers les tournages de Is It Scary et de Ghost. À quel moment tu as vraiment ressenti ce besoin d'écrire ça?
You know, I never thought I would write a book, but after he passed away, so many stories were coming out about him. Some were about me. You know, I would read on the internet and I'm like, that's not true, you know? And it really was reading things that weren't true. And I wanted people to know the Michael that I knew. And I knew the only way I could do it was through a book, because it took that long to explain it all. You know, you can't just like say, oh, this is what happened and that's that. It takes an entire book to really understand not only him, but my relationship with him, all the crazy stuff that happened. Like, I can't make this stuff up. You know, it was one of those moments in time that I know will never happen again, because it was just, when I look back, I'm like, wow. Was that really me? Did that stuff really happen? Because now none of that crazy stuff happens. You know, I'm just living kind of a normal life compared to that. So yeah, I'm glad I wrote it down back then. I had a journal that I wrote all this stuff in. And I'm really happy that people are able to read it now, because for years I wished I could tell people, you know, all this amazing stuff that happened, this crazy stuff that happened. It shaped my life, because, you know, I was young, I was in my 20s, and that was who I was, and it's where I come from. And for people to know me now, they need to know where I came from, because, you know, it wasn't like a normal life I led. So yeah, I wanted to kind of I wanted people to know the Michael that I knew, which I think if they read the book.
Alors maintenant, la grande question, es-tu plutôt Ghost ou Thriller?
Yeah, well, see, Ghost is like 40 minutes long. Thriller is like 15 minutes long. So it's hard to even compare the two. But if you compare it with the dance scenes, Ghost is like way better than Ghost is way better than any dancing I've ever seen in my entire life. So that's better. Michael's acting, you know, is better. He looks better to me. So yeah, Ghost wins. Michael accomplished what he wanted, because that was the thing he told me. I, as I said on that phone call when he asked me to be in it with him, he said, I want this to be scarier than Thriller. And it is scarier than Thriller for sure. So yeah, that was his goal, and I think he accomplished it. That was his goal and dream. So I'm glad that most people feel that way, because that's what he wanted, and it would make him happy to hear you say that.
Alors Shana, cette interview est terminée. Merci beaucoup d'avoir pris le temps de répondre à toutes ces questions. Merci pour toutes ces petites anecdotes, pour tout ça. Un très très grand merci.
Peter, thank you so much for having me. I'm so happy you're doing this special Ghost show, because Ghost deserves to be heard and seen, and I'm so happy to share my stories. I had such a wonderful time filming Ghost with Michael. So thank you for interviewing me and for having this show all about ghosts. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Merci beaucoup, Shana.
Je remercie toutes les personnes qui ont pu partager mes vidéos à chaque fois que je postais quelque chose sur Pete World. C'est vraiment super, un grand merci de ce soutien. Ça fait maintenant quelques mois qu'on vit ensemble l'aventure et ça, c'est vraiment génial. Merci beaucoup. Un grand merci également à Christophe Boulmé et à Shana Mantagal qui ont pu prendre de leur temps afin de répondre à toutes ces questions. Merci pour toutes ces anecdotes, pour toutes ces choses qu'on a pu apprendre ensemble. Vous pouvez toujours me retrouver sur les réseaux sociaux juste ici, Facebook, Instagram et TikTok. Et au fait, is this scary? Ah!